He is a global CTO of Genesis Solution, a multinational company based in 7 different countries. The founder of Girls in Tech Nepal chapter. He's the South Asia lead for women in big data, Amazon ambassador, Microsoft certified trainer, and also a passionate academic facilitator. Let's welcome Anjani Phuyal to talk everything AI. Welcome, Anjani.
Thank you very much. Hello, everyone. Am I audible and visible as well?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, let me my screen share. Okay, please confirm my screen is visible as well.
Yes, it is.
Okay. Hello, everyone. And namaste from Anjani Phuyal. Okay, maybe if everyone can mute now. Perfect. So, okay, hello, everyone. Today, I'm going to present on Amazon Web Services Machine Learning Services. There are probably 20 plus Amazon machine learning services. Machine learning or artificial intelligence itself is a very vast topic. So this talk is more of a 100 level, which is designed for early starters in artificial intelligence and machine learning services. But definitely, I hope this is going to be useful for those who already have started their career in AI and ML. This will help them to guide further on which direction they want to go, leveraging the power of Amazon Web Services, the tools and services Amazon has provided. So the host has already done a brief introduction of myself. So I'm currently working as Global Chief Technical Officer for Genesis Solution. We are a digital transformation company headquartered in UK and operating in around 8 different countries. And I'm currently working as Chief Executive Officer for Genesis Cloud Academy, organization which is focused to bridge the gap between academia and industry. So this slide shows a brief about myself. So by profession, I used to be electronics and communication engineer. Later, I went into computer major. The logos that you can see on the slide are the organizations that I have worked in the past. If I have to summarize my last 15 years of experience, I would say it's all about digitization. And if someone asks how you did the digitization, then it's all about using cloud computing. And now it is even more evolving. Like cloud computing has enabled technologies like big data, artificial intelligence, machine learning, so that we can even create awesome platforms and services to the end customer. So again, some of the affiliations that I currently hold. So I have been working as a Amazon Partner Network Ambassador. The role of the ambassador is obviously to flourish the knowledge that Amazon has been building to the community. And this platform has provided me a right opportunity to showcase the services, the power that Amazon actually has. Similarly, I have been working as a voluntary role as a founder of Girls in Tech Nepal, a US-based non-profit organization. And similarly, I represent Global Executive Committee member for Women in Big Data as well. Again, they both are organizations working on building on 3 pillars: women, technology, and entrepreneurship. And similarly, the platform, currently Zoom, which we are currently using, I represent Zoom as a global partner advisory council member as well. Personal side, I'm proud father of 6-year-old daughter as well. As a location, I am primarily based out of UK. I live in an ocean city in UK called Plymouth, but I do a lot of travel, and travel is one of my hobby. In terms of technology side, initially, I started my career with Microsoft Technologies. I used to be Microsoft certified trainer with probably 10 plus or 15 plus certifications from Microsoft, starting my career as a Microsoft certified professional, Microsoft certified system engineer. Later, when I realized the power of cloud and when it was heading in that direction, I jumped into Amazon Web Services. Currently, I hold around 10 plus certification from Amazon, Microsoft Azure certification as well, some of the Alibaba cloud certification, and some of the traditional certifications like Cisco and monitoring tool Nagios and those kind of services. Now let's dive into artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning. So it's a buzzword, and everyone hears like AI, ML, deep learning. So what is the difference? So I think this slide, I try to mimic or articulate what is the difference between all these different services or different terminologies that we use in our day-to-day life. So as you see, AI comes in a broader picture. The subset of AI is machine learning. And again, the further subset of ML is more of a deep learning. So how the machine learning works? So again, there's a career misconception which I have seen in a lot of people. They're like, oh, I want to be an AI engineer. But how AI or ML actually runs on the background is without data, you cannot actually do machine learning. The core fundamental for machine learning is data. So obviously, if you do not have prior knowledge of working in data or understanding of data engineering, then again, that's going to be tough as well. As you can see, you feed in the data to the model, that's where the ML engineer come into picture. You actually design the model, you write the machine learning flow, and then the outcome is the prediction that we bring. So input as a data, model as more of a processing engine, and then the prediction as an outcome. But I always used to say, if you are learning engineering, or if you are actually doing engineering for the sake of engineering, then probably it doesn't have much value, because engineering should be to make human life easier. So if doing ML, building an ML model, it's just for the sake of engineering, then probably it doesn't hold much value. The value comes when it creates a meaningful prediction, and that actually simplifies the problem that we have in the society or in the industry as well. Okay, so the challenges before ML. So before ML started, the concept of doing the prediction and those kind of things, it's just not a new concept. It has been there for a long time, but they were doing it in a different ways. Maybe there was a mechanism of building multiple threaded scripts, or maybe multiple rule engines, and which wasn't actually scalable. For example, rule-based systems, it wasn't scalable at all. And again, hand coding difficult systems, that wasn't sustainable as well. And again, trying to figure out multiple scenarios, if else, another if, another else, and all those different kind of conditions. Again, what happens if the new scenario comes outside of the test scenario? So, all these different mechanisms that was used before ML that actually failed and couldn't scale, and hence the concept of ML actually started evolving as well. And now it is being used rapidly. Similarly, artificial neural network. So again, it has deep learning has been mimicking how human brain actually works. I think following the mechanism of the brain working pattern, there's input, which actually the output of one actually input acts as an input for various neurons, and then ultimately we get one output. So there's one input, multiple layers of processing, and then a single output at the end. So ML and technology advancement. So as you have seen, initially there used to be data centers with massive computing powers. So they used to actually do the computation and then bring the result out, but that wasn't easy enough. And because of the lack of computing power that was required to process probably deep learning algorithms and those kind of things, it was really difficult to get the output. But now with the power of cloud computing, be it Amazon, be it Google, Microsoft, Alibaba, or whatever cloud computing, these days ML and AI has been much easier. And if you want to run really large computation of large data set, that is feasible as well. So some of the common business use cases, I think everyone uses Gmail, and you have a folder spam, junk, and all those kind of things. So now you can automatically see they're being classified maybe this is a spam and it goes under your spam or junk, or maybe on the promotion tab, or there are various tabs there. So that's one of the common business use cases. And it is actually making life easier, because I started using email when it was time of hotmail.com, and you have thousands of emails sometimes coming, and there's no way to identify what is right email, what is not wrong email, and you might overload yourself. But probably I think it is actually helping in a lot of good way, but still there are challenges. There's improvement that's required as well. The another use case would be the recommendation engines. Again, talking about Nepal, the shopping behavior had just recently evolved, I think, in terms of e-commerce. But thinking on the global scenario, I think people's life depends on e-commerce and online shopping. And now, if you just recently moved a home, I recently moved a home, you buy maybe an oven, then they will actually recommend you're buying an oven, maybe you need, maybe a fryer or something. If you are buying a washing machine, they will say maybe you need maybe dryer or something, depending upon the country you are, and the brands and all those kind of recommendation engines actually is one of the good business use case as well. Again, the fraud detection engine as well. So, you know, I used to work for a Capital One bank, and one of the, you know, challenge was like, previously people used to, you know, find out the fraud happens when the customer sees the additional expense on their credit card bill, which comes after a month, and then they complain to the customer service, and then the investigation happens, and then finally, you know, the fraud is detected, and then the refund process takes probably another month. You can just imagine the customer experience with that mechanism. So now with the automated fraud detection, which is again another beauty of powered by ML, that, you know, if a fraudulent transaction is happening, then a customer get alerted automatically. Maybe they will get a text saying, hey, you know, someone is trying to use your card to do a shopping on this store with this much amount. If that is you, just press Y or press N on your text message or something. And then, you know, either the transaction goes through or it actually, you know, halts as well. That's another probably a common use case of machine learning and fraud detection engine as well. Again, you know, I have, you know, classified some of the benefits of ML. I think, you know, all of you might be already aware of, you know, these benefits. I won't go into details. So now let's go into quickly types of machine learning. So we have supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement learning. So I won't go into details, but a quick one. So the use case for supervised learning, so it actually uses classification or, you know, regression algorithm, which actually can be helped to build a system like, you know, fraud detection, image recognition, customer retention, medical diagnostics, and, you know, maybe forecasting, weather forecasting, market forecasting, even population growth prediction. So these are like, you know, some of the common use cases. And similarly for unsupervised learning, it uses algorithms like clustering and, you know, dimensionality reduction. So this would be actually used for more of a product recommendation, customer segmentation, maybe even NLP processing as well, or even gene sequencing as well. Let's go into RL, reinforcement learning. So it is a mechanism where trial and error method is actually being used to build a better system. For example, you know, maybe self-driving cars is a good example. You can actually see a mechanism called Amazon Dip Racer. This is one of the product from Amazon. It's like 1/18 size of a physical car, which has like, you know, all the IoT devices, like, you know, cameras, sensors, and everything. And it is actually, the RL algorithm is developed and deployed to the car. And then we let the car run on the track. And if, for example, it is making, you know, positive move or expected move, then, you know, we reward. It's more of a reward recognition mechanism. And then with trial and error, we train the system so that it try to, you know, cover all the scenarios that is out there and then, you know, perform. It can be actually applied to robotics, you know, maybe customer service routing and all those kind of different use cases as well. So again, the self-driving vehicles, which is again going to be a new norm probably going forward, you know, from petrol to diesel, it has evolved into electric, you know, with automatic cars, and even current cars actually has a lot of automation, like, you know, maybe the cruise control method, maybe they call it like, you know, ACC, I think they call it, like, for example, if you are running on, let's say a 70-mile speed or something, and if there's like a blockage, then it detects the blockage and then, you know, it slows down the speed automatically. So it's getting even more intelligent, and hopefully we can see a world where I think most of the cars will be running in automated way as well. So again, in terms of future of ML, more of a, I think it's going into deeper personalization, product recommendation, self-driving cars, even a lot of investment opportunities actually are driven by ML services now. They will recommend, like, you know, what's happening. Maybe there's some problem in the Afghanistan, and which probably share you don't need to, you don't want to invest, and, you know, all those kind of intelligent recommendation is going there as well. And even for the medical diagnosis as well. For example, one of my first-hand experience I was working in the past was building a system where you take a picture of an eye and then, you know, you fit into the system. The system actually, you know, analyze how dry your eye is, how wet it is, how much, you know, diabetic retinopathy you have, whether, you know, the eye has a glaucoma or not. And then, you know, building a doctor-assisted technology, like a PDF report saying, hey, it's all good, you know, or it's all green, you don't need to worry anything about it. Or it could be like, hey, you know, there's a problem on this particular segment of your eye and maybe you need to go for, you know, deeper analysis or something. Or even like, you know, going in an area where, you know, we might be detecting like, you know, skin cancer. And usually what they say is like, you know, the model is actually built by feeding tens of millions of customer, tens of millions of patient skin images, which is actually helped to build a system. Now the authenticity of result coming from that system is going to be probably much advanced or better than what a doctor is actually going to produce, because maybe a fresher doctor working in the cancer department might only have maybe 5 years, 10 years, 15 years experience, and he might only have access to, maybe thousands of images. But this computer system going to have access to tens of millions of images as well. So that's where I think the world is heading as well. Now, looking into job demand in AI and ML, so this is in thousands. So you can see in 2010, it's more of a 20,000, in a range of 20,000 vacancies are available, which requires AI skills. And now you can just see it's growing in 2019, it's 219,000. So it's not actually decreasing, it's actually increasing. But what I would like to highlight is even though it is increasing, AIML job category is not something for, maybe not necessarily for university graduates. I would recommend that at least you have 1 or 2 year experience in programming or some experience in data, and then you deep dive into these areas will actually help you, grow and foster your, career path in a very nice way. Now let's, jump into the Amazon Web Services machine learning stack. I think there's again a misconception that, to do or to leverage the ML services, you need to be really expert on programming and, all those kind of things. But I would say now that is sort of myth. So if you want to, leverage some of the, the SaaS platforms or solutions from different providers, then that's readily available as well. But bear in mind, that doesn't give probably the depth you might be looking into. If you want to have your own customized service, then that's where the deeper understanding of the algorithms is required. But that's where Amazon again comes into picture as well. So if you look into the top layer where I have, we have classified as application services. So on the vision side, there's Amazon recognition for image recognition, recognition video is there for video analysis as well. Similarly, on the speech side, we have Amazon Poly and Transcribe. On the language side, we have Lex, Translate, and Comprehend. So this gives a readily available APIs and SDKs. So you input your image, you input your video, and then you get analysis outcome out of that. I'm going to do the demo in a few minutes as well for some of these services. Similarly, if you want to build your own model, you deploy your own model, you train your own model, then that's where the platform services come into picture. For example, Amazon SageMaker is there. Again, Amazon DeepLens is available for developers as well. So you can actually, deploy your model, put it on DeepLens, and then that model can actually does the analysis and give you the outcome and result as well. Similarly, there are Spark and EMR clusters are available as well, and Mechanical Turk services are available as well. Now, if you want to go on a framework and infrastructure level, again, that's where Amazon Deep Learning, Amazon Machine Learning images are available as well. So you can actually run your own, MXNet, Apache MXNet, or TensorFlow on GPU, P3 instances, or there are services IIT Green Grasses as well, which actually can run on the edge as well. Okay, so I'm going to run a quick video. Let me do my sound sharing. If there's any problem on the sound as well, please let me know on the chat message. So I'm going to run it, which actually showcases the Amazon Core machine learning team member as well, what they say about the product development. And after that, we will go into a brief demo of some of these services as well. So I'll be logging into the Amazon console and then showcasing how these services and how we see the outcome as well.
It is an exciting time to be doing machine learning at Amazon. We have a ton of data, first of all, customer purchase transactions, a catalog with over 1 billion products. This is the largest selection of products on the planet. We have millions of reviews and a variety of digital content, ebooks, videos, audio, and so on. And we have a broad set of very interesting and challenging problems where we are applying machine learning techniques to. For example, we are using machine learning to forecast the future demand for a product, to predict the lowest competitor price, or to just find product substitutes and complements.
We really help Amazon innovate on behalf of customers. Most of the work that we do is in partnership with a team from the business, but we're the center of excellence on machine learning algorithms. So we have the opportunity and we have the responsibility to take the latest research. Often we improve on it to solve our problems. And then we take risks in investing and developing new methods that we hope will create a step change improvement in customer experience. And sometimes we succeed, sometimes we don't succeed, but that's the nature of being experimental.
A primary dimension for measuring success is that we're only successful if our customers are successful. And our customers are our partners, the teams in retail, the teams in customer service, the teams in operations, the teams in Amazon Web Services, or the teams in digital. And with those teams, the measurable dimensions of success is, do we increase selection for our end customers? Do we lower the prices for them? And do we increase the customer experience through the use of machine learning in these products?
As a manager in machine learning, I'd say that I have two major goals. The first goal is to do the right thing for customers, to try to develop algorithms that will power experiences that customers will really welcome. The second goal is to do the right thing for the people in my team. We recognize there's a lot of competition in hiring machine learning talent, and we want people who join Amazon to be happy at Amazon, to be excited when they come to work in the morning. And I think we achieved that.
Okay, a quick overview of computer vision now. So again, as we know, it's the automated extraction of information from digital images. And again, the whole point is to build something meaningful out of it. What are the use cases? I think that that's where the sole focus should be. Being an engineer, initially, I felt very proud on building engineering systems, which is awesome. But I think where the focus should be is towards the customer. And that's what one of the main motto of Amazon is as well. They said they actually work backward from the customer, find out what is the problem, and then try to find the engineering ways to solve that problem, not the other way around, not doing the engineering and over-engineering without understanding what is the end problem. For example, some of the applications that the computer vision will actually help to solve is public safety and home security, autonomous driving, as we discussed earlier, authentication and enhanced computer-human interaction, medical imaging, content management analysis, manufacturing process control. It is actually going to help quite a lot into the industrial 4.0 revolution as well. Like helping to probably minimize the defects that the industry is actually producing by probably taking the pictures of the image during the industrial manufacturing process, doing the early detection, probably alerting and all those kind of things are some of the use cases as well. For example, this is probably a food served in a restaurant or maybe in a hospital, or it could be in any year. What are these now? So it's food, breakfast, lunch, dinner. So, that actually does the analysis. For example, it actually shows the picture had the food had the tray has like something with milk and the confidence score. The confidence score of having milk in that food is 97.1. And now this actually helps a lot of other, problems as well, because I didn't actually realize until I came to UK that, the allergy problem is so prevalent. Maybe that's one of the beauty, burning or growing in Nepal. Luckily, I do not have personally any allergies. But when I came here, I realized, people have lacto allergy, people have nuts allergy, and all those kind of things. Maybe, a better implementation of the systems can actually help, gain and probably mitigate those problems. So you can actually see, the analysis of this particular food item. Okay, similarly, into the, content recognition or video analysis as well, could be used in a gaming, identifying probably which person, and I think probably on the other side. So this is again, video analysis or picture analysis of a shopping mall, where we can actually see in what cluster people are locating. This could probably be an example of Apple Store or something. I've seen Apple Store this big, where there is different Apple devices and people go there and then just try and demo and those kind of things as well. Could be any store. On the video analysis side, what is the angle the player is hitting the ball? What is the motion estimation, action recognition? And this actually can be helped to, build even better system as well. So Now let's deep dive into Amazon recognition, which is one of the type of computer vision. Maybe let's quickly go through the slide and then I'll go into the Amazon console. So again, it's a managed services. So as you see, it does the image analysis, and then we can actually do a searchable image and video libraries once the analysis is done. This can be used for security and compliance as well. Okay. So it can be integrated into various languages as well. SDKs are available for JavaScript, Python, PHP, and various other languages as well. So for example, face detection, you input the image and then you figure out, what is the outcome of this image, for example. And you do not need to, build any complex algorithm. You do not need to build any complex algorithm to achieve this, for example. Similarly, again, object and scene detection as well. Again, these services are available for people who even doesn't have much understanding on, AI and ML as well. So let's go to, So I'm actually logged into Amazon console now. What I will do, so on the console, you go to services, you can actually see the various suites of machine learning services. So as I said, this is pretty entry level and I wouldn't go into depth on all the services, and probably each individual service will require hour of our time. So time is not a good friend here in this particular case. So now let's try to figure out where is recognition, or you can actually just do a search from here as well. Okay, I'm pretty bad on that. So let me try rec. Yeah, so that's Amazon recognition. So there are three ways you can interact with Amazon services. The first way is you can actually use the console like I have been using for demos and visible to increase the visibility. This is one of the pretty effective medium. The other one is you can actually use Amazon command line services. So there are libraries, Boto libraries and stuff on Python, which can be actually used to, do the command line. And similarly, as I said, the SDKs are available as well. So you can actually, embed with your, choice of programming language as well. So in this case, now, it's pretty obvious on the console, there's something called try demo. I try the demo. And there is one image here. That's a sample image already there. And we can see the analysis of the image on the right-hand side. So, this actually does the analysis of the image, says the image has actually car, and the confidence score of the image having a car is 98.8%. And, various things there's a human, there's a pedestrian, a skateboard, and you see various things, and the confidence actually, keeps on decreasing as well. And the question could be how is this useful for developers? How can, we consume these things now? So again, the example is, without even building a very complex model now, you input your image using the API services or API calls, and then you get the output in the form of, let's say something like this, JSON format. You can actually see the outcome, the confidence score, and with this, you can actually build an awesome service. So again, as I was saying, you don't need to worry on building the whole algorithm and a stack now that is running behind, but rather you can leverage the power or the services that is already available, and then you can actually build some meaningful services out of it. Okay, so similarly, I can run some of the facial analysis. So again, I wouldn't probably just go on the, let me try some of the images that I have on my system. Okay, so I will try to showcase some of my images. Oops, that's not ideal. So okay, the problem is, my image size is pretty big. Okay, I think this is better. So in this case, it does the analysis. So it says it looks like a face. 99.9% appears to be male. That's perfect. Age range, that's between 32 to 48. So I'll let audience to, decide whether that is true or false. Smiling, yes, perfect. That's smiling as well. Mouth is open. All these kind of, aesthetics are actually, available. Does not have mustache. Okay, maybe in this case, no. Doesn't have beard. The confidence is 51%. Yeah, okay. Now, there's various categories, it does the level detection, image moderation as well. So if it is adult content or maybe not family suitable or something, it does the moderation and then it is actually blurring it. If you want to view maybe this more of a, you know, kids content here, you know, you can actually go into the another category as well. And then, you know, it is like probably a female wearing a swimwear or something. Is it good to, you know, showcase in probably a family thing or something? So again, you know, you can do the, you know, the moderation. Facial analysis is something that I just did. Celebrity recognition is probably another, you know, beautiful feature as well. So, I mean, you might be just wondering or maybe saying, yeah, you know, why not Jeff Bezos or maybe you know, Andy Jassy? That's pretty obvious, right? That's the system Amazon built. So why don't we try and do some of the, you know, other celebrity recognition as well? You know, I can take a feedback from the audience if you want to, you know, give a name of any of the celebrity that you want me to download and then try the system as well. I'll just do a quick message check in case if anyone is, you know, sending any messages here.
Yes, we have a few questions that have come in, but for now, if anybody, okay, Lionel Messi.
Okay, sure. Yeah, and I'm happy to take, you know, some of the Nepali celebrity as well. So I'll take the questions at the end. Probably we will have around 15 minutes time. I'll try to rush through the demo as well. As I said, like, you know, time is not a good friend because I have a lot of awesome stuff to present. Okay, Messi. So let's try to download the image of Messi. Maybe this one. So I save the image. No, actually I always do the other way around. I take a screenshot, that's easy. Okay, in the meantime, try to, you know, just give me other names of the celebrity as well.
We have one for Bhartika Rai, who is a Nepali singer-songwriter.
Yeah, so that's, I just took a screenshot. Okay, so we have Lionel Messi. And then we have a response like this. So, you know, you, as a developer, you can actually, you know, give an input of this image and then get an outcome like this. Again, use cases in terms of use case. So in our company itself, you know, what we did was we actually built an attendance system. So with your mobile device, you know, you take a picture and then just do a clock in, and then it actually, you know, checks your email with the already registered emails on our S3 database. And then it actually does the clock in or clock out and those kind of things as well. Or some of the you know, interesting use cases could be if some celebrity is coming in Nepal, for example. I think there was an occasion when I think Prince Charles, or I'm not sure, someone from UK actually came. So how would we know that some celebrity is coming in Nepal? You know, we have a camera deployed on probably in the immigration system. And then it will just, you know, does the image analysis and then alert to the authority saying, hey, we didn't realize, you know, we have some of the royal family from UK is coming, or maybe even Messi is coming, and all those kind of things. And Nepal is, you know, no surprise land for such kind of interesting thing to happen. And there was an occasion when like some big, you know, Hollywood celebrity was, you know, walking in Asan Gully or somewhere and no one actually recognized that. I mean, I don't know, it could be some of the, you know, use cases I'm saying. So I think there's another celebrity name. Bhartika Rai. Okay. So. Okay. Maybe this could be the better picture now. I hope to see the one.
We can't see your screen right now, so the audience can't confirm.
Okay, no problem. I'll just stop my screen share. Yeah, so I took the screenshot of this picture. So let's try to upload now. Yeah, I do not know. Okay, it doesn't recognize anything. Okay, so let's try someone who is very popular. So I think in a lot of time, you know, I do the demo, and I think I do Rajesh Amal. Okay, now some people might be saying like, you know, okay, you know, they already have a database, you know, what's the new thing on it? So the beauty is if you want to build your own system, that is feasible as well. You know, this gives you the idea of, you know, how the system works. And now you can actually, you know, build your own system. If the database doesn't have probably, you know, all these Nepalese celebrities, then you can actually, you know, add on the database and then build your own model and system as well. And you can figure out, you know, the use case. But that's where I think I'll go later onto the machine learning services like, you know, SageMaker, where you can actually build your own model. Okay, so I wouldn't go into, you know, looking all the celebrities. As I said, like, you know, this is probably for those people even who are starting to have AI or ML sort of, you know, discussion. So you can actually go to Amazon console yourself in, and then try yourself as well. There are like some of the other, you know, services like, you know, facial comparison. So, you know, you can actually in, you know, Hindi movies, we used to watch like, you know, Kumke Mele Me Chute Hue, Bichra Judua Vai or something. So, you know, you can always have like, you know, those two different images and then do the comparison and then see, you know, what is the matching percentage and stuff as well. So in this case, the girl over here and then the girl in the middle does the 99.9% similarity, but then she doesn't have a matching with other people. I mean, you can try with your own stuff. Unfortunately, all the pictures I have of myself seems to be very big size. I think the system doesn't let to upload more than like, you know, 5 MB of the size. So I don't think I can, yeah, I don't think I can run it myself. Okay, so now let's go into text in image. Pretty straightforward. So more of an OCR, and you can just imagine how accurate it is. Like, you know, there's a, it's Monday, but, you know, keeps smiling and the response is in the JSON. You can actually see that's Monday there, you know, that's, but keep. So all these things are already, you know, available. And I think, yeah, it's here, so result, right? So that, that's a, you know, OCR example, and you can just imagine how easy it is. Another interesting thing, and this actually, you know, explains the evolution and probably the agility of the platform as well. So, you know, when the COVID started, this service wasn't there earlier, PPE detection. Again, I have one image I took when I was on one of the public sessions just right before the second pandemic in Nepal. I tried to, yeah, that's a big image size. Sorry, I think this should work. No, this doesn't work. So this is the picture. I tried to make it less than 5 MB. So, you know, here is a picture of audience in this, in the screen you can see, some wearing PPE and some not wearing PPE. So I'm just uploading that. Again, there is no, you know, I'm not trying to pinpoint who is wearing mask and not, but for example, it actually showcases like, you know, person with required equipment, you know, how many person, there are like, you know, person number, this is with ID, this is without the, you know, PPE. For example, it actually clearly detects, you know, who is wearing mask. Yeah. Yeah, so there is someone who is on the back. Okay, no, he's still wearing the mask as well. I think there's someone who is not wearing the mask and putting it on the neck. So, and again, you can actually, you know, do the different edition here, like, you know, hand cover, the head cover, and then what is the confidence you need? For example, do you need 80% confidence? Is that okay? And this is actually being used for industry, for example. What you can do, the use case, if someone is not wearing the mask and, in, you know, entering inside, I don't know, maybe ministry or maybe school, colleges or whatever, then the camera does the detection and then it doesn't let the people in, or the door doesn't get open or something, right? So you can actually, you know, use the system to build a compliance system, for example. Face cover on the nose. Oh, that's pretty interesting as well. So you can see, like, you know, maybe I'll just, this is pretty obvious, yeah? So in this case, the picture, is she wearing a mask and covering the nose? So she's wearing the mask, that's true. Face cover on nose is true as well. Head detected. So, I mean, if there's a, you know, maybe in a factory, for example, you know, in restaurant, people need to be wearing, you know, that cap just like this, for example. So if someone, this is more of an industrial sort of thing, like, you know, for the safety that's required. So it doesn't just need to be COVID, you know, it could be for a lot of use cases. And that's where I was saying earlier, and I was trying to focus. Engineering is good, but try to focus on the end result that it is going to produce, the, you know, the beautiful use case, and then try to come backward. So the other part I would quickly highlight is more of a video analysis. So again, I'm not going to do demo with the live video, but I'm just using a sample video that is already here. And this actually works with, you know, your own video as well. For example, the kind of system we were building in Nepal was, you know, taking a CCTV video image of the CCTV cameras in the traffic in Nagdunga maybe, and then trying to, you know, split that video into images and then figuring out what object is in the video frames, for example. Is it like car or truck or motorbike or whatever? And then trying to identify the number plates, like an NPR recognition system as well, right? So that could be one use case. So in this case, it does the video analysis and you can see the result. In the video, there are two people. Now you might know who this person is. Anyone can guess who this person is? Maybe if it was a physical event, I would have given some, you know, Amazon swags, but unfortunately I cannot now. So it does like, you know, people, two celebrity, and then it does like, you know, what are the objects and activities detection as well, right? So in this case, you know, I can go, okay, two people, two celebrities, that's Werner Vogels, who is the CTO for Amazon, and Jeff Bezos as well, and then objects and those kind of things. So I highly encourage all of you to, you know, go into the console and then try to leverage. It's pretty easy. And the demo that I'm showing here is because I'm just trying to showcase how beautifully easy it is for you to try yourself as well. Okay, so I won't go into detail on this now. So let's quickly go back to this slide. Okay, so my slide is visual as well. Again, the slide actually showcases the same thing, like this more of a, you know, scene detection as well. Okay, now there's one interesting use case of all of these. I mean, it's not just Amazon recognition, various services of Amazon has been used to build this system. I think a lot of people might know already what Amazon Go is, but I'll quickly play 2 minutes of video on Amazon Play, and I think my audio is. Okay, so this is an old video, but the Go is already available in a couple of states in US already now. I personally haven't got opportunity to actually use Go, but I think you already got the gist. Okay, let me try to minimize it. Sorry. Okay, how does it work? Yeah, it's minimized as well. Actually, someone just sent me a message with, you know, one comparison that I want to do. So what I just did is I actually my current face is, you know, fine as well. So I just take a screenshot of my current face. So someone actually, you know, sent me a picture that is my old picture. So it must be somewhere in downloads. Yeah. By date created. Okay. So please do not laugh on the picture. So this is a picture with a beard. So let's try to compare, you know, what happens with this. So I can do face comparison. Again, you know, I'm not validating the authenticity or accuracy. So that's where I think, you know, we got to work to make it better. So on the download, you know, there is a picture. Okay, yeah. So there's this picture of me with a big beard. This old picture. And I'm just trying to upload another picture, which I just took as a screenshot. Okay, that's this. Okay, so that's me during the last year lockdown when I was bored and then started growing my beard. And this is me now, you know, I don't have my hair and anything. And the similarity is 99.3%. So, I mean, this is one practical example. Okay, so let's go to back to the slides now. Discussed on the go as well.
4 years ago, we started.
Okay, so now let's quickly do the overview of, you know, NLP, natural language processing. So when I was talking earlier regarding, you know, this number plate recognition system, so it sounded so nice. You know, I did the architecting. The idea was like, you know, to input the, you know, the CCTV image video and then do a frame extraction, which is pretty straightforward, not too complex as well. And then each, you know, images would be done analysis with Amazon recognition, and then we do the object scene detection, which actually says, you know, whether it is a card, truck, or those kind of things, and then do the number plate recognition. But the challenge started when we realized that, you know, not all the number plate of Nepal is, you know, that ambush number plate or something, which has like, you know, it's pretty standard format in English language. We have like, you know, bar, eggs, or bushetin or something. And now how we do the extraction of that. That's where, you know, the NLP expertise was required as well. That's one example of where the NLP was used. Again, you know, I use Alexa quite a lot as well. Alexa is another, you know, the, what do you call it? Like speech, I would say powered system, I would say, where you can actually, you know, give an input as a voice, and then if you get the outcome as a voice as well, it does all the processing on the background and you get the results. So when my daughter grew, you know, by the time she was born, I had Alexa, and she thought like, you know, Alexa is part of her system. She thought like, you know, she's a human, and she used to get upset when Alexa doesn't understand her accent when she could barely, you know, speak as well. So, you know, these are some of the interesting use cases as well. Some of the use cases would be more of a, you know, searching in the application, human machine interface. Alexa is one example here, you know, using chat, building chat boards as well, market and social research, trying to figure out, you know, what is the brand, you know, awareness in the market, what is the sentiment of people on the brand, and those kind of things as well. So there are like, you know, some of the services called Transcribe, Poly, Translate, Comprehend, and Lex, which actually does a lot of NLP. You know, they are like a managed services for natural language processing. I wouldn't demo all of them. I would demo probably some of them. For example, Amazon Transcribe, what it actually can does is like, you know, it can recognize your recorded voice, and then it can actually do the translation, does the extraction of the text as well. So it could be like, you know, subtitle enabled system or something similar. I think someone is trying to maybe point something on my screen. Please, you know, do not do the annotation. So that's the Amazon Transcribe. Again, this is more of a SaaS platform. You know, you can actually, you know, input your audio and then, you know, get the transcribed text automatically. So that's something you can try from the console. Okay, so some of the use cases would be medical transcription. So you might have heard, like, you know, there's a big job, a big market of medical transcription in Nepal and US in the past. A lot of doctors, you know, they used to speak, and then they don't have time to write anything. And that's where people in Nepal, we used to have people wearing the headphone, listening the, you know, the medical the conversation, and then, you know, doing the translate with the, you know, writing in a manual way. But now that job has been completely replaced with, you know, systems like, you know, Amazon Transcribe, for example, you know, like a leveling of streaming content leveling as well. The surprising thing is, like, you know, I'm really bad on, you know, recognizing the actors and actress, but I watch a lot of movies. And now the beautiful thing for me is, I think it is on Amazon Prime Video. So you pause the video and then you point to the particular person, and then you know who the actor is now. See, it's so much, you know, the beautiful thing for me, because my wife always, you know, makes a fun of me saying, hey, you don't know the celebrity. And she even intentionally tried to, you know, just give a different name to a very popular celebrity as well. So yeah, it's a good thing for me as well. Subtitles is another example. You know, call center monitoring is another example as well. There is another service called Amazon Poly, which converts text into speech. So I'm going to demo this quickly from the Amazon console. So it actually can actually detect various languages and then convert into, you know, speech, which is pretty beautiful. And we are trying to, you know, use this service to build some meaningful thing for visually impaired people or those people who cannot read and write. Because, I mean, my mother, she never went to school and she doesn't know how to read. She's just learning. So She should have access to latest news and services. That's where this service can actually help. Again, these are like, you know, my ideas of building services. You know, you can actually use various mechanisms or think or be creative to build a lot of meaningful services out of it as well. So some of the examples: new service production, language training, you know, navigation systems, animation production as well. Similarly, there's translate as well. So it does, like, you know, obviously with name, pretty straightforward, does the translation from one language to, you know, another language as well. Okay, so the use cases is, you know, maybe translation of the website, you know, software localization, multilingual chat boards, or international media as well. Amazon Compliant, one of my very favorite service. It actually does sentiment analysis as well. I won't go into details. I'll probably rather demo those quickly. So some of the use cases of Compliant, like document analysis, fraud detection, mobile app analysis, or content management as well. Amazon Lex, again, you might have, you know, seen a huge chatbot. Building chatbot is so much easier using Amazon Lex. You can actually build in a matter of 30 minutes. Some of the use cases, more of a, like, inventory and, you know, sales analysis as well, interactive assistant, you know, customer service interfaces, or even database queries as well. Okay, so let's quickly, you know, do some of the demos before I move into, you know, the Amazon SageMaker. Okay, my screen is still visible. So I would quickly go into Poly. Okay, Amazon Poly. So here there's a pre-built text. So let me try to, you know, do the pre-built text for now. So you can see the text here. Hi, my name is Joanna. So it actually does the detection. It's English language. And the voice is, you can actually choose, you know, different voice category as well. So in this case, I'll just choose, you know, Joanna female. So just do the listen. I think my audio is here.
Hi, my name is Joanna. I will read any text you type here.
Okay, so I just, you know, added some text. Let's let Joanna read that text now.
Hi, my name is Joanna. I will read any text you type here. Really then, can you read? I'm Anjani and I am from Nepal.
Yeah, so you see, like, you know, the text I have written. And the beauty is, like, you know, recognition, it is not just accessible from the console. You know, you might see, like, you know, what is the near thing here. The beauty is it is actually accessible. You know, for example, you can actually save to Amazon S3, which is like a very popular storage, so, you know, service from Amazon. You can download in MP3 as well, and then you can embed, for example. And some of the, you know, practical use case, which even Amazon is leveraging, for example, I follow a lot of Amazon blogs, for example. So there's a blog site, and, you know, there's a person who does the blogging quite a lot. Oh, okay, this is written by Danilo. Okay, so, you know, you know the blog here. It actually says voice by Amazon Poly, and there is an audio you can hear as well. For example, I just play the audio.
Introducing Amazon Memory DB for Redis, a Redis compatible, durable, in-memory database service. Interactive applications need to process requests.
Okay, the beauty is it's a lot human-like, actually. That's the beauty. So quickly, let's try to see if we can do anything with Hindi. Or people might say, why not Nepali? Yeah? So okay, let's go to online cover. Okay, sorry, my computer seems to be struggling. Okay, so I'm going to one of the Nepalese news portal. So the Nepali language is not natively supported. So you might hear something funny. But I just wanted to showcase, you know, where it is heading, where the direction it is heading. So again, there is no interest of, you know, getting anything political here. This is just the first news that I saw on online cover. I'm just grabbing that. Okay, Amazon Poly. Now, yeah, there is something called Hindi. So we didn't have Nepali, or else I would have gone Nepali. So this looks like, you know, maybe our Indian person is speaking Nepali language. So it might be a little bit funny. Oops. Does it not let me copy? Okay, now I'm going to play this.
छह भदो धनगढ़ी नेकपाए माले चाडेर वरिष्ठ नेता माधव कुमार नेपाल ले नेकपाए एकीकृत समाजवादी गठन गरेपछी सुदूर पश्चिम माउनी निकटका नेता अलमलमा परेका छन केंद्र मा माधव नेपाल लाई साथ दिनदयाए का भीम रावल तटस्थ बसेपछी सुदूर पश्चिम मा त्यसको प्रभाव देखिए को हो.
Okay, so again there are like lot of lexicon or improvement we can do to make it proper Nepali like, but in Hindi it actually does a proper pronunciation. So I'll let all of you, you know, try if you are keen as well. Okay, so another one. So I would do the final demo of Comprehend. So Comprehend is, as I said, more of a sentiment analysis service. Okay, so I go to Comprehend, launch Comprehend. So in this case, there's already, you know, prefab text. So I would rather just remove it and I'll write my own text. Okay, my system is not behaving too well. So I am Anjani Phuyal. I'm a good boy. Okay, I still prefer to call myself boy. So I'm Anjani Phuyal and I'm a good boy. So let's do the analysis of this particular text. Sentence. Okay, I do the analysis. So now the result in terms of insight, it actually highlighted, you know, Anjani Phuyal. So, I mean, it's not a known English name, but it identifies that Anjani Phuyal is a person and the confidence score is 0.99 plus. Okay. So key phrases used in the sentence, Anjani Phuyal, a good boy. It's a language, it's English language. The confidence score is 0.95%. This is another beautiful thing, like PII. In Nepal, we call it KYC, know your customer data. In probably in European countries or in the Western world, we call it PIA, personal identifiable information. So this is very crucial for the compliance reason, GDPR or HIPAA and all those different kinds of compliance. So it actually identifies if, you know, someone, if there's like a, you know, PIA information on the sentence as well. So in this case, the PIA information is Anjani Phuyal. And another must, you know, valuable thing, which I really like, is the confidence of the sentiment of this particular text. So in this case, it is neutral. The positivity is 71%. There is no negativity on this thing because, you know, I said, I'm a good boy. Now, for developer, you know, you can actually do the syntax checking, which is, you know, pronoun, verb, proverb, and all these kind of things. And for developer, you know, you can actually do all these things on the as a JSON format, as well as API response. So you can actually hit the API endpoint and get the result. So now I'm Anjani Phuyal, I'm a good boy, but I sometimes get upset when people don't mute their mic. Okay, don't mute their mic, fine. Okay, so I do the analysis of this text now. So, okay, I mean, other things I wouldn't go. I'd rather quickly go into the sentiment now. So if you see sentiment, previously there was no negative, you know, connotation on the sentence. Now we have 0.12%, the confidence score of being negative because I, you know, introduced the word like, you know, upset and stuff as well, right? So this is, I'm just making an example, right? So it's fine. People can make mistakes. That's not a problem. So again, the beauty is with these things, you can actually build a meaningful system. For example, talking about, you know, maybe global brand like Amazon. So Amazon definitely CEO would want to understand how is their e-commerce doing? What is the brand reputation of the e-commerce, right? So they might want to use the system from, you know, scrapping the tweet and reviews and all those kind of things and then say that, okay, you know, my brand reputation score is this. It could be used in, you know, a lot of various areas as well. Okay, so now let's quickly go into the summary side now. So I know we are already running you know, out of time probably. So Amazon SageMaker is more of a platform services. So you can actually build your own model, train your own model using Amazon SageMaker. You know, there's like a notebook available as well. You can write your code and deploy as well using Amazon SageMaker. Okay, so we're gonna go into detail on that one. So now the final thing is, so all these, you know, awesome services, as I said, you can actually, if you are looking to have your career to start on this area, then there is something called Amazon Academy, and Amazon Academy helps you to grow your career in that area. So myself being one of the Amazon Academy, you know, accredited instructor, we provide training services to Pulsok College now. So Pulsok students are actually, you know, teaching themselves or, you know, studying themselves with the Amazon approved curriculum. Pulsok is Nepal's first Amazon, you know, academy as well. They study probably 3 subjects with 9 credit from Amazon syllabus. So I'll quickly, you know, play a video of, you know, the value of Amazon Academy and then showcase how we can access the Amazon Academy curriculum and then do the wrap up.
AWS Academy really is an effort to reach out to higher education institutions and to collaborate closely with them. So on our side, we're offering benefits to those institutions in terms of authorized and maintained curriculum, courseware that those educators at the universities can easily incorporate into an existing class or have it as a standalone class for their students. We believe that by collaborating with higher education institutions as a partner, that we can work closely with them and with their educators and faculty members to provide that courseware and lab and other hands-on experiences that students need in order to prepare them for jobs that really are ready and waiting as the cloud migration occurs throughout the world.
When a student finishes our Academy Cloud Architecture course, they're able to more deeply understand how these resources work together from a perspective of troubleshooting, of identity and access management, the concept of least privilege. Being able to stand up an architecture that's not only highly available, meaning resilient to intrusion or attacks, but also scalable to meet demand, which is sometimes out of their control. We also introduce serverless architectures, things like Lambda, and how to use our managed services in order to eliminate some of the complexity behind standing up resources.
If an instructor and educator wants to blend the content and have the students do a lot of the pre-work and pre-reading outside of class time, that's fine, because all the lecture notes and all the slideware is available for students to be able to do that independently on their own, so that when they come to class, the professor can spend more time on team-engaged learning, project work, lab work. Having said that, for those that are more comfortable in a more traditional lecture-driven environment, that's fine as well, because all the lecture notes, all the material is there for them to use the class time to go through the courseware in a more traditional manner. So I see it as the best of both worlds.
The students are really leaving the class with not only the theory, but also the hands-on practice. But a lot of the studies have shown that they really retain more when they're doing hands-on practice. Part of the thing that I think really helps them transitioning out to the workforce is the lab environment that AWS Academy gave us. So they were able to get the lecture that night and then also go right directly into the lab with what they've learned and go step by step and actually build these things that we were just talking about. So I think it really helps to kind of cement it into their heads. And that helps them too transitioning out to an employer who maybe wants somebody who can come in and work with their AWS environment. These people are coming out of Bellevue College. They know how to do these things. You know, it's not just I picked this up from a book. It's I've actually done this. I remember how to do this.
We have found the AWS Academy to be a really interesting and very useful device for us. It's useful in a number of ways. Clearly, our students who've gone and achieved certification are very attractive in the marketplace.
These students need to be prepared for the cloud computing jobs that are waiting for them. When you think about the demand that exists with industry, we know and they know that they need better prepared and larger quantity of graduates. That's the invitation to participate with us collaboratively. It's a complementary program. We're strategically investing in this, and we're asking you to invest a bit of your time and energy to adopt cloud computing curriculum, courseware into your...
Okay, so once you go through, you know, these knowledge of these services, you can go into the certification track where for machine learning, there is something called Amazon Certified Machine Learning Specialty. But I wouldn't focus to go into the certification directly. You know, you go through some of the fundamentals of cloud, some of the ideas of how you can do the data processing and stuff, maybe doing the cloud practitioner, some of the associate level or developer level exams. And then you can actually go to this direction. This will actually help to, you know, make your employability much higher as well. Okay, so these are some of the requirements. I know it's with less time for Q&A. And then you can actually contact me here. Just take a picture of these details. If you need anything more in the future, either, you know, contact the organizer to reach out to me, or you can reach out to me directly. I'm very much active in, you know, these social media platform. And a quick demo of the curriculum academy courses for machine learning. So for example, in Nepal, we have been providing these access to the courses for Amazon machine learning courses. For example, you know, you have access to LMS, Canva LMS. You can actually, you know, have all the curated video content here, introduction of machine learning, for example. There's a module knowledge check at the end of the each module, you know, implementation of, you know, machine learning pipeline with SageMaker, maybe introduction computer vision. All the details are accessible. And if someone wants to, you know, get access to these courses, then please reach out to me as well. You know, I'm more than happy to onboard you on these courses. Together with these courses, you get access to the lab platform as well, where you can actually learn and experiment as well. Now, I know it's a bit of more time, so I would like to wrap up here. And if there's any question that I can answer, then I'm more than happy as well.
All right. I think that was an extremely fun presentation, especially with live examples. I really loved the comparison between your 2020 photo and your live photo. We are in a bit of a crunch of time, so I'm just going to take a few questions from the audience, starting off with Samip, who is adamant about this question. What do you think about transfer learning systems?
Okay, so I'm not sure, you know, what you mean by transfer learning system. So unfortunately, I don't think I can actually respond this one. If you know, this is something, the wording is different for me, then I can look into it and get back to you. So please ping me on the email and then I can respond back on the email.
All right. So let me move on quickly to the next question. That is, as for my major project, I tried to use AWS Student Pack in order to create site and then try to create model by it. But AWS seems to only support registered colleges, which I feel most of the colleges from Nepal, also mine, are not in those lists. So how do you suggest a student go forward with ML using AWS?
Yeah, really good question. So again, you know, one of the proud things that we say we have enabled Nepal is 2 years back, there was no colleges registered. There was no people who could have access to these Amazon, you know, awesome Amazon platforms. But we have given access to roughly 10,000 plus students in these 2 years time. So even though your college is not registered, we first try to see if your college would be interested. If not, again, please, you know, send me details of your request on the email. Even your college is not registered, I'm more than happy to, you know, enable you on the platform so you can get access to the platform and leverage the services. Your college doesn't need to be registered.
Fantastic. Okay. So the next question comes from the same person who asked, how does testing work for models? How do you know the model doesn't fall in some scenario or doesn't work as expected, like what happened with Uber self-driving car? How do you determine its reliability?
Yeah. So the whole idea is, you know, you build a model, you test the model, you know, I mean, there's no shortcut for testing. You know, you test in multiple scenarios, you figure out, you know, which could be the, you know, the blackout zones and all those kind of things, testing in a simulated way, testing in probably, you know, where the human are not there, and then finally deploying it in the live system. And hence, you know, the live system is very dangerous. The ultimate way is, you know, to build a system, test multiple times. There is no other shortcut for that. Because of that, I mean, the self-driving car was there probably 2 years or even 5 years back, right? But it is not still in the mainstream is because of that risk. And, you know, a lot of authorities are concerned that maybe enough testing is not done, that enough data is not, you know, collected as well. Yeah. So over the time with enough data and enough testing, that would be possible.
Right. Okay. So we have time for one last question. And this comes from Sushil, who asks, is there any service on AWS which helps to visualize the biasness model is trained on?
Sorry, can you repeat again?
Any services on AWS which helps to visualize the biasness model is trained on?
Okay. Is there any service on Amazon which helps to visualize the biasness model is trained on? Okay. So again, the question is not very clear, but what I would say, so if we're talking on, you know, biasness on AI and those kind of things, yes, that's a new thing that is being, you know, coming. I think there was like one tweet recently tweeted where there's like two hands, one with probably not fair skin and one with a fair skin, you know, requesting a Uber. And then, you know, the guy with the not fair skin has like, you know, two times more of Uber fare than the other guy. So, I mean, yes, it has been said that, you know, there's a lot of, because the training data itself has, you know, biased data, and that's where I think the algorithm is detected that way. There are a lot of movements that's actually happening to not actually train AI on using the biased data. So if that's the area that you are referring, then that's what I would like to say. But again, happy to have a detailed conversation on your question as well, if you know, you have more details. Thank you very much.
All right, great. And that was our last question for Anjani today. Like you mentioned, if you have any other questions, queries, or comments, you can reach out to him at his contact details, which was shared before. If not, you can get his LinkedIn link on the Syntex website as well. Thank you, Anjani, so much. I think this was a fantastic and a fun presentation.
Thank you very much, Kritika. I think there's one interesting question here at the end. TensorFlow, Swift, or PyTorch? I have TensorFlow in the past, back in 2015. But I think now I started using PyTorch. I mean, it's not like either or. There are use cases for both, but now I'm leaning more towards PyTorch. Thank you.
All right. I hope that answers your question, Mikey. We'll be right back with our first lightning session speaker for today, Pratish Shrestha, co-founder at Honeycomb. So stay with us. Until then, why don't we all take a break? Thank you, Anjani. Talk to you soon.
Thank you, Kritika. Have a good day.
All right.